God be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, in your tender love for the human race, you sent your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, to take upon him our nature and to suffer death upon the cross, giving us the example of his great humility. Mercifully grant that we may walk in the way of his suffering and also share in his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
The first reading comes from the book of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 50. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning, the Lord God wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. Cynthia, will you please take over? Thank you.
The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare me guilty? Hear what the Spirit is saying.
Thanks be to God.
Have mercy on me, O Lord, for I am in trouble. My eye is consumed with sorrow, and also my throat and my belly. For my life is wasted with grief, and my years with sighing. My strength fails me because of affliction, and my bones are consumed. I have become a reproach to all my enemies and even to my neighbors, a dismay to those of my acquaintance. When they see me in the street, they avoid me. I am forgotten like a dead man, out of mind. I am as useless as a broken pot. For I have heard the whispering of the crowd, fear is all around. They put their heads together against me. They plot to take my life. But as for me, I have trusted in you, O your face to shine upon your servant, and in your loving kindness save me.
A reading from the book of Philippians. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name. So at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Hear what the Spirit is saying.
Thanks be to God. We will now hear the Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. You may be seated until we arrive, until we reach the line where they mention Golgotha. It was 2 days before the Passover and the festival of unleavened bread. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him, for they said, while Jesus was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at the table, a woman came with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment of nard, and she broke open the jar and poured the ointment on his head. But some were there who said to one another in anger, and they scolded her. But Jesus said,
let her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has performed a good service for me. For you always have the poor with you, and you can show kindness to them whenever you wish. But you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anointed my body beforehand, before its burial. Truly, I tell you, wherever the good news is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in remembrance of her.
Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went to the chief priests in order to betray Jesus to them. When they heard it, they were greatly pleased and promised to give him money. So Judas began to look for an opportunity to betray Jesus. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, Jesus' disciples said to him,
where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?
So Jesus went with two of his disciples, saying to them,
go into this city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, the teacher asks, where is my guest room, where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there.
So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as Jesus had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, Jesus came with the 12, and when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said,
truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me.
They began to be distressed and to say to him, one after another,
surely not I.
Jesus said to them,
it is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him. But woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born.
While they were eating, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to the disciples, and said,
take, this is my body.
Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them,
this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God.
When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them,
you will all become deserters, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee.
Peter said to him,
even though all become deserters, I will not.
Jesus said to him, but Peter said vehemently,
even though I must die with you, I will not deny you.
And all of the the disciples said the same. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I pray."
Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, and began to be distressed and agitated. And he said to the three disciples,
"I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake."
And going a little farther, Jesus threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said,
"Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you want."
Jesus came and found the disciples sleeping, and he said to Peter, "And again, Jesus went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found the disciples sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. Jesus came a third time and said to them, Immediately, while Jesus was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, and with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given the crowd a sign, saying,
"The one I kissed is the man. Arrest him and lead him away afterward."
So when Judas came, he went up to Jesus at once and said, and kissed him. Then the crowd laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them,
"Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled."
All of Jesus' followers deserted him and fled. A certain young man was following Jesus, wearing nothing but a linen cloth. The crowd caught hold of him, but he left the linen cloth and ran off naked. They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter had followed Jesus at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest. And he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against Jesus, saying,
"We heard him say, 'I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another not made with hands.'"
But even on this point, their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus,
"Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?"
Jesus was silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest asked him,
"Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?"
Jesus said,
"I am, and you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven."
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
"Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard this blasphemy. What is your decision?"
The whole council condemned Jesus as deserving death. Some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying to him,
"Prophesy!"
The guards also took Jesus over and beat him. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said, But Peter denied it, saying,
I do not know or understand what you are talking about.
And Peter went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed, and the servant girl, on seeing him, began again to say to the bystanders,
this man is one of them.
But again Peter denied it. Then after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter,
certainly you are one of them, for you are a Galilean.
But Peter began to curse, and he swore an oath.
I do not know this man you are talking about.
At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered that Jesus had said to him,
before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times.
And Peter broke down and wept. As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him,
are you the king of the Jews?
Jesus answered him,
you say so.
Then the chief priests accused Jesus of many things. Pilate asked him again,
have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you.
But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now, at the festival, Pilate used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now, a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then Pilate answered them,
do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed Jesus over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have Pilate release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again.
Then what do you wish me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?
The crowd shouted back,
crucify him.
Pilate asked them,
why? What evil has he done?
But they shouted all the more,
crucify him.
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, Pilate handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers led Jesus into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters. And they called together the whole cohort, and they clothed Jesus in a purple cloak. And after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him, and they began saluting him, saying,
hail, King of the Jews!
They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. The soldiers compelled a passerby who was coming from the country to carry Jesus' cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then the soldiers brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of a skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And the soldiers crucified Jesus and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified Jesus. The inscription of the charge against him read, the King of the Jews. And with Jesus they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided Jesus, shaking their heads and saying,
aha! You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross.
In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking Jesus among themselves and saying,
"He saved others, he cannot save himself."
"Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe."
Those who were crucified with Jesus also taunted him. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani,"
which means,
my God, why have you forsaken me?"
When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, and someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to Jesus to drink, saying,
"Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down."
Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now, when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way Jesus breathed his last, he said,
"Truly, this man was God's son."
There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, and Mary the mother of James the younger, and of Joseph, and Salome. These used to follow Jesus and provide for him when he was in Galilee. And there were many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. When evening had come, and since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also himself waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate wondered if Jesus was already dead. And summoning the centurion, he asked him whether Jesus had been dead for some time. When Pilate learned from the centurion that Jesus was dead, he granted the body to Joseph. Then Joseph bought a linen cloth, and taking down the body, wrapped it in the linen cloth and laid it in a tomb that had been hewn out of the rock. Joseph then rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where the body was laid. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. This Palm Sunday liturgy has always been a puzzle to me. We start with cries, joyous cries of Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest, and today we processed around the block. It was only raining a little bit. And we made it all the way around the block singing that glorious hymn and came into the church. And then immediately upon entering the church, the tone of the service changes. And we have this passion reading where Jesus is betrayed and arrested and killed. Jesus entered Jerusalem to cries of Hosanna. Now, Hosanna is an interesting acclamation. I always thought of that word Hosanna as being equivalent, really, to Alleluia. After all, it's one of those words that we sing out joyously proclaiming Jesus. Alleluia, God is great. Alleluia, Jesus has come. Hosanna today, Hosanna. But it turns out that Hosanna and Alleluia have different meanings. Hosanna means literally, save us, God. Save us! Now, in Hebrew, verb tenses are fluid. They have many possibilities of meaning. And so, Hosanna can mean, save us, God. But it can also mean, God is saving us. Or it can mean, God will save us. So all of those meanings were possible as Jesus processed into the city and the people cried out, Hosanna! Hosanna in the highest! And that makes sense for first century Israel. God, save us! These people were living under Roman occupation. Now, it's hard for us to imagine what that might be like. We don't live in an occupied country, but we can imagine taxes. You can imagine what if your taxes just kept getting higher and higher and higher to the point where you couldn't pay them? The Romans were notorious. They were famous for their efficiency in collecting taxes. But that's not all. There was also Herod, the puppet king of the Jews, and Herod had his own taxation. He was taxing the people in order to build a city in honor of Rome, Caesarea Philippi, it was called. And he was also taxing the people to rebuild the temple as a sign to prove his legitimacy as king of the Jews. But even then, we're not done. There was also the temple tax. If you want to participate in the religious life of your people, you must pay the temple tax. So that's three different taxes, all of which must be paid. And this triple taxation, now the Roman taxes were by far the most onerous. This triple taxation was crushing to the people. Families were being forced to sell ancestral properties to pay their taxes to Rome. And wealthy landowners who could pay their taxes were buying up their land. And people would end up forced to work as laborers on their own land. Or if they owed too much, they might even have had to sell themselves into slavery and end up working as slaves on their own land. Not their land anymore, or worse, maybe they couldn't pay their taxes at all and couldn't come up with the money, and they just end up as homeless people, hungry, with no place to live, no land to call their own. Hosanna, God save us indeed. It's into this circumstance that Jesus came. He comes and he presents himself as a Messiah figure. The procession of the palms that we reenacted today was political theater. Jesus was making a very clear statement that he is the Messiah, the one that will bring the restoration of God's kingdom to God's people. And they knew what he was doing. That procession riding on a colt with people waving the palms, that was a reenactment. It was a fulfillment of the words of the prophets. Now, at the same time that Jesus was entering the city on one side, in this peaceful procession, crying out, God is saving us, at the other side of the city, there was another procession taking place. And that procession was led by Pilate. Pilate was at the head of a column of soldiers with chariots and war horses and swords. And they were coming into the city because every year at the Passover, the population of Jerusalem would double and triple as all the people came in from the countryside to celebrate the Passover feast, this great feast that went on for days and days. And when all of those people got together and started complaining about the Roman occupation, well, that's when the trouble started. And so to avoid trouble, Pilate would just bring all of his troops right into the city to keep the peace during the Passover. So two processions, one from either side, coming into the city. And in fact, we know that there had already been an uprising. Remember the character Barabbas that Pilate released? What were we told about him? He was in prison for murder, having been one of those who participated in the insurrection. So there's already been trouble. Pilate already knows that he needs to send even more troops into the city to avoid more trouble with these troublesome Jews who won't accept the Roman occupation. The scene is set. The people are hoping for salvation. Hosanna, God will save us. And the Jewish authorities are worried about another uprising, another brutal Roman response to the uprising. And the Romans are worried about trouble in Jerusalem. And Jesus comes into the city, already famous as a healer, as a preacher, as a teacher, as a prophet, already famous for having fed the multitudes in the wilderness. But let me ask, what does all of this have to do with eternal life? For the last several weeks, everything we've heard, all of the statements of Jesus have been about eternal life. They've been an invitation of one kind or another into that abundant life in God's kingdom, that life that is infused with the love of God, inspired by the Holy Spirit, led by God. That life is what he's inviting us into. And what does that have to do with all of this? We face a choice. We have to choose between the values of this world and the values of God's kingdom. That very contrast between the triumphal entry, the procession of the palms, and the crucifixion illustrates that choice for us. The contrast between a life following the values of this world and a life committed to trusting in and loving God. What will we spend our money on? How will we spend our time? Where will we look for satisfaction, for life? Now, the Christian answer to these questions is found right in this story. And that's how it relates to the question of eternal life. The contrast between the procession of the palms and the passion of Jesus reveals it to us. Now, as I was looking at the story this week, I realized there are three distinct contrasts. There's first that contrast between the two processions, the procession of the palms with Jesus and people proclaiming God's salvation, and the procession of the chariots and war horses and soldiers. The second contrast is between trusting in wealth and power versus trusting in God's love. Remember, Jesus goes into Jerusalem and he goes to the temple and he sees the moneylenders and the people selling doves and other animals for sacrifice, and he's outraged and he overturns the tables of the moneylenders. Courtyard has been turned into a marketplace. People are buying and selling animals for sacrifices. They are exchanging Roman coins for the temple coins to pay their temple tax. Now, There is a profound difference between love as a transaction and love as an act of generosity, of caring. It's really quite simple. You can think of it as when you do something for someone simply because you love them and not because you want something from them. That is love as an act of generosity. If instead you do things for people so that they will do things for you, that's something else. That's some kind of transaction. And so Jesus sees the temple turning the relationship between the people and God into a kind of transaction, and it offends him. And the third contrast is between living for yourself and for your own needs and for your own values versus living for the good of others. Jesus is willing to face down Pilate and the religious authorities to show us God's love, to show us what it looks like to truly trust in God. He holds to his love and trust in God even in the face of betrayal and crucifixion. And so we reenact the procession of the palms and retell the story of the Passion because these stories shape our lives to follow Jesus. These stories teach us how to respond to power and how to use power for good. These stories show us how to live from love and generosity, trusting in God's abundant provision. These stories show us how to live in God's love. God is love, and God pours out God's very self for us so that God's Spirit is present among us and within us and through us for the world, for our neighbors. We are, after all, the Church of the Good Samaritan. Our service continues today with the prayers of the people. Our Lord comes to us humbly, riding a donkey and proclaiming a message of peace. Let us pray, saying, Lord, hear our prayer.
That Christians hear and share the word of God as true disciples, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all the ends of the earth receive the words of the King of Peace, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all leaders of church and of state prefer humble service to empty power, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who see the cross starkly revealed in their lives draw strength from the name above every other name, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we hope to greet Jesus when he comes again, be ready and joyful, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer. God, our Creator, you show your sons and daughters the way of freedom through the gentle obedience of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant our petitions as we seek to follow him. We pray in his name, Christ the Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. God's peace be with you. Peace be with you. God's peace be with you. Peace be with you, Craig. God's peace be with you. Peace. Peace be with you. I don't see my usual procession of people coming up to make announcements today. So I guess I just have one announcement to make. You will notice that the office tape dispensers have gone missing. Somebody knows where they are. Ah, forget it. We'll just buy some new ones. All right, that's it on that one. Hello, Sharon. Good, how are you today? Excellent, I'm glad to hear it. All right, today, before we have the words, the offertory sentence, I want to say a prayer with our own Melissa. Tomorrow, so it's right away, at 5 a.m., at O'Dark 30, she will have knee replacement surgery. And so we are praying for her quick recovery and for the skill of the doctors and nurses. Please come here. Please stand and pray with me, my friends. Melissa, I lay my hands on you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, beseeching God to fill you with God's spirit of wholeness and health. And Lord God, today we pray for the skill of the doctors, the surgeons, the nurses, the technicians, and everyone who will attend to Melissa at 5 a.m. tomorrow morning and afterwards. We pray that their skill may lead to a precise and accurate and excellent outcome, and that she may recover quickly and be returned to full health and ability and mobility. And all this we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you all. Wherever you are in your spiritual journey, however you found your way into this place, you are welcome in this place and at this table. There is food enough for all. Come and be fed.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For our sins he was lifted high upon the cross, that he might draw the whole world to himself. And by his suffering and death, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who put their trust in him. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Ein Wasser auf
Das Sündenherz entzwei.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you now and always. Amen. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
tower is and then that's